I'm your host, Janine Burns, and I am delighted to be here today with my two guests. First of all, I have Bill Harvey. Bill Harvey wrote the book, Mind Magic. It's all about meditation, being in the flow, and mindful awareness practice, which we'll talk about in just a moment. And our other guest is Cheryl Mchunguzi from the Unity Church of Healing Light. It's over in Huntington Station. And so, welcome. Great to have you.
Great to be here.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us.
Yes.
Absolutely. I always like our format to be conversational rather than an interview, so please feel, you know, willing to jump in whenever you feel appropriate. So, I'm very excited to talk about this subject, spiritual inheritance, because spiritual inheritance is about our spiritual identity, who we are, that we in fact do have this power within us, a creative power that is active, that connects to our thoughts. And when you are conscious of that awareness, you are in the flow. And I'm very curious, how did this all come about? How did mind magic all come about?
Well, it started when I was very young. I was on stage up in the Catskill Mountains doing a stand-up comedy act with my father. And so I had a little microphone, and he had a big microphone.
How old were you?
I was 4.
Oh, that is young.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you want to hear one of my jokes?
Sure, why not?
So I'm reading a newspaper, and he's saying to me, yeah, you're reading a newspaper. And I say, hmm? And he says, how old are you? And I say, 4. And he said, well, 4 years old, reading a newspaper, that's pretty good. And I go, yeah. And he said, you know, you're reading it upside down. And I wait a beat and say, you think it's easy? It's the only joke I remember.
Okay, that's cute. That's cute.
So, I had like terminal stage fright.
Oh.
And, but I had to do it because, you know, I was born in a trunk. I was in the tradition. They would be very disappointed in me, so I had to do it. So eventually I got to a point where I noticed that there were two kinds of performances I would give. Either I would give like a zombie performance.
Okay.
Everything rehearsed and doing it by rote and just trying to, you know, hopefully get through it and can't wait till it's over. Or something would take over, and all of a sudden I'm watching myself. I'm not in my body. I'm kind of like above and behind my body.
Observing?
Observing.
Okay.
Little Billy give a perfect rockin' performance.
Ah.
And the audience is totally wiped out, and everything is great. So I knew there was these two states, at least two states of consciousness.
And as a 4-year-old, you figured
yeah,
this out.
Yeah, but I didn't use those terms.
Right.
I didn't know how to talk about it, even to myself, but I knew there was this other place I could be, and I wanted to always be there. So that's what started it. So I became obsessed with trying to figure out what is going on and what is that place, and how do I get back there.
And in your book, you call it flow.
Yeah, there's actually, there's like two levels of it. There's flow, which we all know what that is. It's like perfect, no effort, and you're not trying to do anything.
Right. Some people call it being in the zone.
Like it's
if you're
the zone.
If you're excited, let's say, you know, you're a tennis player and you're playing, you're on your game. Anything that's you're blessed and you're into doing it, you're in the zone.
Yeah.
Or you're in the flow. Okay.
Yeah. It's usually happens when you're doing something that you're pretty well practiced at.
Okay.
And when you're doing it for play, not for outcome, and you're not attached to failure or success, and then it hits you. But I wanted to get there from here, you know, and so I was looking for interim steps, things that I could do, actions I could take, or ways I could set my mind where it would help me get there.
Okay.
So I found out that there's an observer state, which is like in between normal waking consciousness and the zone. And in the observer state, the thing about it is you can see your ego impulses trying to take you over. And you know where it's coming from, and you don't have to choose to go that way. So you can discriminate between goodness and flow impulses
so you're
and
witnessing.
Negativity impulses.
Right, you can Okay, so you can distinguish between goodness and flow impulses and negativity impulses because you're witnessing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love on page 208 in your book, it says, remember, you are not the chatter that you hear in your head. You are the hearer of that chatter. And so many people so identify that they think that they are the self-talk that's going on there. But Johnny Coleman, a very famous New Thought teacher, would teach, I am the thinker that thinks the thoughts that produces the things in my life experience.
Right. And so what I hear is there's a difference between being an active participant in your life and being a passive participant in your life. When you're actively participating, you are deliberately and you have an intention set for where you're trying to go and what you're trying to do. And I think that's what I'm hearing you say.
Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. Definitely. And we're swept along by other people's ideas, and we're bombarded by information, and it can like take us over. And it's really a matter of distraction.
Yes.
You know, the more distraction, the less likely you are to get into the flow.
And you know, and we're so distracted. I mean, even now, and in your book, I was reading particularly about, you know, as opposed to 100 years ago, how much distractions were there, and how much input and distraction that they'd have like. In a year, let's say, we have that much in a day.
Right.
Because, you know, we have telecommunication, and we have our iPads, and our text messaging, and the emails, and on and on and on, and even all the electronics in our home. And so there's so much input, and there's so much, you know, I know that people, you know, it used to be you had 24 hours to get back to them. Now, if you get back to them in less than 24 minutes,
they're upset.
They're upset, and they're thinking you're not paying mind to them, right?
Yes,
you're not
exactly.
paying any attention. So, yes. Yeah. So, what I appreciated in the book, and I know that Cheryl is very into, is you talk about meditation as a skill, as a tool, as a technique to cut out all those distractions. Tell us more about that.
Well, I think meditation is a natural thing that people automatically do, but it does help to be reminded of it.
How is it natural? What do you mean?
Well, I did it. I didn't know what I was doing, but I would spend a lot of time meditating. You know, there's meditation, there's concentration, there's contemplation.
And so you're to distinguish between meditation, concentration, contemplation. Were you contemplating as a child or were you meditating?
I was both. Like, concentration is focusing the mind on a single point, any
yes.
single point.
Okay.
Contemplation is focusing the mind on a single idea or a thought. Something in the mind, and then contemplation of the self is meditation. So that if you, I mean, the thing that blocks people from wanting to meditate is they think it's going to be boring. But just watching what goes on in your mind isn't boring. It's better than television. It's much more intimate. It's you. It's much more important than television. It isn't just entertainment. And if you observe what's going on in your mind, you find that you are able to not choose to be pulled away or stuck in a negative idea. You have the choice of saying, I know where that negative idea comes from. I know what comes next. I know it brings me down. I lose all my creativity. I get bummed out. I ruin my day. Why do I want to go that way? And besides, what got me there? I was a little too attached to somebody giving me praise 3 minutes ago, and I didn't get it. So now I'm getting this impulse. So this is kind of like a zombie robotic thing that happens. So I don't have to stick with it anymore because
so
I see it.
You're conscious. So you're not on automatic pilot, if you will.
Right.
And you're more conscious and you can consciously make choices
Funny.
As you begin to witness the thoughts.
Yeah.
And I also think people think meditation, you know, they think of yogis and sort of twisting up in a pretzel and, you know, they think that they have to quiet the mind, but you don't. Like you said, you could concentrate. You could just do some breathing techniques, you know, breathe in through the nose and out through the mouth and just count your breaths and as concentration. And then for contemplation, you know, you could take a spiritual word. How do you do contemplation and meditation? Because I know you're a meditator, Cheryl.
Well, for me, meditation is the setting aside of all the chatter that is around, the chatter that's going on in your head on a daily basis, the voices that are telling you yes and no and pulling you all types of directions. And really stilling yourself to hear the right voice, because there's a lot of voices, like you said, during the day.
Okay.
So you I still myself to hear the voice of my divine inheritance, my inheritance, the power of the universe.
So you still yourself to hear the voice of spirit within,
yes, spirit
which
within.
People call intuition.
Yes, intuition.
Yeah.
So therefore, I am not distracted by those things. So I still myself, so therefore, I'm hearing the right voices
right.
and ask the right questions. Sometimes in chatter, you're not asking the right questions, so you're not going to get the right responses. But in that stillness.
That's interesting. I like that in that chatter because sometimes I call it the silver hammer experience. Why did I do this? How did I attract that? What's wrong with me? How could I be so stupid? And that's what we do. We do self-flagellation. I think we're saying the same things.
Yes, I think
but maybe because of new thought, the word could be a little shifted because, you know, my understanding is that mindful awareness practice is the witnessing of the thoughts, is being mindful and being in the present moment. How would you define mindfulness?
I would agree. Yeah.
Okay.
And the objective, I think, of mindfulness is to get into this higher state of consciousness where you are you have true freedom from the chatter, and you're more receptive to the zone.
Right. Well, you know, you can't control the thoughts that come into your mind. You can control whether or not they stay there. I've said that Chinese proverb, the one that you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from making a nest in your hair, right?
Yes.
That's a good one. All righty, well, we will be back to talk more about flow and mindful awareness and meditation right after this commercial break. And please join us for Spirituality Rocks.
Peacefully. Believe.